Hi, everybody. Welcome back to the Collective. I am Del Salvador, best hair in the game, and this is Acid Bath when the Kite string pops. Acid Bath is one of those bands where you can't really put them into a genre because they do all of them, kind of. It's a very rare thing, but usually, you know, you have a band do a one sound, you know. A band does grunge, a band does classic rock, a band does thrash metal, whatever. And usually they tend to stick to that, you know, that thing. And sometimes, you know, bands will try and venture out of that, and usually it 90% of the time ends up in failure. And sometimes, rare times, it'll work. And with Acid Bath, it's a really rare exception where, they're doing a lot of different genres, a lot of times, in one single song, and pull it off amazingly. And as much as Acid Bath is amazing, they are not really well known that well, for a myriad of reasons. And that's the whole point of the channel, to make sure, you know, certain artists who don't have the right recognition get the recognition, and make sure bands that do have it don't get forgotten, all that kind of stuff. I've said it before. Anyways, Acid Bath are an extremely talented band with very little output, only two albums, but you only need two albums for these guys. The first track on this album, called The Blue, is probably, I'd say, one of the best metal songs in any of the subgenres. Probably, period. I'd say probably top 10 for sure, you know, because it manages to do a lot of different types of metal in one song to a very high degree. You start off with some very almost experimental stuff. I can't remember any artists off the top of my head, but, you know, very experimental, just, you know, weird drums, weird guitar sounds. Then you go straight into some Black Sabbath style riffs. And then you go into some, I want to say, groove metal, maybe even thrash style riffs. Then you get some punk style riffs at the end with the drums going a lot faster. And then you go back to some Black Sabbath type riffs with some classic rock kind of soloing. And it tends to be all over the place. And that's how this whole album goes, which is amazing. Usually certain bands with their album flow, they'll have, like, you know, a chaotic song, a quieter song, you know, a slightly more amping song, really amping song, and that's usually how album flows go. And with this album, what they're doing is they're within the songs, they're having full arcs and full turnarounds and things. The Blue transitions right into Tranquilized, and it keeps the pace, but does slow down near the very end. The third track, Cheap Vodka, is not as varied. Definitely more punk in this song. Or at least very punk sounding, very similar at least. The fourth track, Finger Paintings of the Insane, there's some synths, and it's very doom metal-ish, but the only reason I wouldn't say doom metal for this song specifically is because it's not as slow as it should be, but the riffs reek of doom metal. Just that very oppressiveness, you know, those very dark minor tone, or not minor tone, minor triad, that kind of stuff, tritone, all that kind of stuff, you know. Dax Riggs, the vocalist, does a lot of spoken word poetry here and there throughout this album. Real cool stuff, really dark stuff, but, you know, that's just how it be sometimes, you know. The fifth track, right? One, two, three, four, sorry. Fifth track, Jezebel, it's probably, you know, you can say it's thrash, you can say it's punk. For a lot of these songs, it kind of doesn't really have a very specific genre for the whole thing. They kind of tend to it changes a lot, but no matter what genre you want to put it or subgenre, a lot of these songs are very, very mosh-friendly songs. You know, you can put these on, and most time, besides all the tempo changes in the songs, it's very easy to just, you know, let the music take you, you know? And that's the other thing that this band does a lot is, as well as switching genres pretty frequently in the middle of a song, they also change the tempo a lot in the middle of the song, which if you're a musician, you know, it's insanely hard to do. And in this song, Jezebel, they kind of tie in the lyrical content with the tempo changes in this song, you know, to kind of build anticipation. You know, you have like these build-ups, more spoken word passage talking about murder and stuff, and then right when it drops and the tempo slows down, screaming, "It's okay, it's okay, it's okay," etc., etc. The sixth track, words, "Screaming the Butterfly," is one of those songs that are mostly acoustic and very beautiful, but also very dark songs. Really, smartly written lyrics, really beautiful lyrics throughout this song, you know, which I can't remember off the top of my head. The next song, "Dr. Seuss Is Dead," this is where we get straight up doom. And this kind of is where the album dips, you know, it's kind of for Butterfly and Dr. Seuss, it's kind of, we're on the slow spot. And Dr. Seuss Is Dead starts off, like I said, very doom, you know, actual doom, actual slow and menacing. And it over the time, kind of speeds up very slowly. And it's kind of similar to certain Tool songs and how they progress, where it starts off kind of slow, it'll build, have a little dip, and really pick it up by the end, that kind of thing. The next song, "Dope Fiend," a lot of cool pinch harmonics, you know, and that's another thing, is the mixing on this album, especially on the drums, is very unique. The guitar tones are really amazing, and the bass tones on certain songs, certain intros or outros, are also very, very, very nicely done. And let me tell you, pinch harmonics with how these guitars are tuned, extremely tasty stuff, extremely nice stuff. This sounds all right. It keeps the pace, and it doesn't really do anything interesting to me. It's not a song that stands out, you know, like The Blue does, or Finger Pains of the Insane does, or Screaming the Butterfly does. It's just kind of there. It keeps you engaged. It does keep the pace of the album, but it's weird, because I wouldn't say I'm bored throughout it. It's keeping me engaged. There's enough stuff happening, but I wouldn't say it stands out too much. It just keeps that pace going. The next song, I cannot pronounce the name, Tabu Kamumi or something. The translation, or at least the in parentheses, it is Land of the White Cannibals. Again, moshing. Very, very mosh-friendly song. Very mosh-friendly song, you know? It ends a tad slower. Not extremely slow, but it was a little slowdown. That song's great the whole way through. The next song, "God Machine," starts off with some samples of some spoken word of a lot of people not too happy with religion as a whole and stuff, and got some more spoken word poetry from Dax saying the God Machine is hungry for individualism, and right brains and skull farmers do their rain dance and pray the machine falls to sleep. He has a lot of that kind of stuff throughout this album. And the next song, track 11, "The Mortician's Flame," very, very nice song. Bit slower, a great bass for the whole thing, nice groove, definitely a great song. The next song, which on my script I've abbreviated, I forget what it's abbreviated for. Damn it. I was doing so good. The next song, track 13, again, a lot more moshing. "What Color Is Death?" That's the song title, sorry. We're moshing again. The second to last song, "Bones of Baby Dolls," it's kind of Screaming the Butterfly Part 2, where it's very acoustic, and I wouldn't say it's as good as Butterfly, but it definitely it's there. I was not exactly a fan. At this point, I was kind of checking out, but that also might be my ADHD. Could be, well, either or. But it did not exactly grab me right away like a lot of the other songs tend to do. There are some cool little runs here and there the guitars do that are quite nice, but as a whole, the song's kind of alright. The last song, "Cassie's Cocktail," the last song, "Cassie Eats Cockroaches," is kind of industrial in a way that Ministry would be on albums like "Minus Terrible Thing to Taste" and of Land, Rape, and Honey, where they're using very similar styles of sampling. People screaming about stuff, looped in almost a beat at certain times, and I can say the album definitely ends with a bang. I would say definitely that the first half of this album is a lot better than the last half of the album, but I'd say as a whole the album's really, really good. You know, like I said, if you had to put this somewhere, it's probably sludge metal, I guess. That's what I hear, but that's more of a production thing. If we're talking about what the songs actually are, you know, you got doom, you got punk, you got thrash, you got a lot of different things in there going on, and all being done at a really high level. And this album is definitely worth your time. If you have not checked out Acid Bath, you definitely should. I do have a CD over here of their stuff. Right there, I do have it. I'll put it there for now. If I had to give this album a rating, it'd probably be a good 7 out of 10. This is definitely a phenomenal album. Probably even, if I think of it a bit more, probably say even 8 out of 10. But this is a very phenomenal album. This is very good. Definitely worth your time. That's about it. So I'll see you in the next one. Yeah.